Can everybody hear me? Can someone give me the feedback?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Are you guys seeing the windows on my screen? Apart from the presentation, are there any windows overlapping that? I have a chat window open here. Can you guys see that?
No. No, sir.
Okay, we have 29 students. What is the usual count? You guys had lectures before, right? Online ones for this batch. Give me a approximate number, not the exact number. Do I have to wait more? Or... And you can also use the chat. I'm looking at the chat. I know you guys are shy to talk, so I am looking at the chat. So you guys can type in whatever you want. I can see them. Can someone give me a feedback about the student count? We have only 29 participants. I know the badge is around 100 participants, right? Okay, usually we get around 50 students for this subject. I'll start at 1:35. Okay, let's start. Can someone put something on the chat window? Just send me a message, put text or something, because I need to verify the messages are coming. Okay. So if you if you are shy to answer me publicly, you can set the message to send direct messages. You can set that here, right? To host or something. I know there's an option. Okay. So I am getting some messages. Okay. So I will share the enrollment key. I have a question. Okay. So you guys are now going to start the third year. And so as you can see from the module code, electrical installations and EC3232. So you guys know when you have the second digit is 2, that means this is a power subject. and but I am recommending everyone to choose this subject because most of your batch is going to end up in electrical installation firms after graduating, because I know that for a fact, because I am also a graduate from SLIT. So I know from last several batches, most of them are going to end up in electrical installation side. And so maybe you may know me, I am Sharath Jayasekara, and I have a postgraduate diploma in electrical installation. So I am doing this subject for the second time this year. And usually our student count is around 50, but for this lecture, we have only 32. Anyway, okay, we can start. And this will be a very small introduction to the lecture. I will go through some stuff we are going to learn in this lecture, and we can discuss your, so this time will be different, right? Because you guys didn't go to the industrial training. So last year, people had some exposure to the industry, so they found this subject a bit easy to understand, but we can try. This subject is usually an easy subject. Last year we had 50, and around 28 had above A minus, as I remember. So usually grades are in the upper level in this subject. And grading structure is, you know, a bit different from other modules. We have 50% CA and 50% final. So CA component will have one assignment and three labs and mid-exam. Mid-exam will be 25%, assignment 15%. And this subject will not have a very huge academic load because the most of the things are not that theoretical, mostly practical stuff. You only have to do some small calculations to select the electrical installation components. We are going to learn about them. So not very hard subject, and you guys can see the enrollment key. You can write this down somewhere. Then I will upload the lecture, and I will also send this to your year coordinator, I think Miss Sachin, right? So she will share this with you. And you know, you earned 30% of your GPA from last 2 years, right? Only 30%. So we still have 70% to earn. So from the first year, first year 10%, right? First year 10% and second year 20%. So you have completed those 2 years now, and you have 70% in upcoming 2 years. So even if you did not manage to score very high marks in first year and second year, you can still go for a good class, because you have 70% to earn. And you can easily manage to get a second class. If you work hard, you can go for a second upper class. If you had lower marks in the first 2 years, if you had very high marks in the first 2 years, you can easily score for a first class. So, and those are the things you need to know when coming to the third year. So third year is a bit tough than second year, but it is because you have several projects. So you will have a year-long project as design project. So you will be asked to select a supervisor for the project. And because of that, there will be some time management issues with the third year, but you can manage an easy subject like electrical installations without an issue. Okay, so this is what we are going to learn in this module. And so let me ask you a question. You can type in the chat. So tell me, give your own answer. What do you think about electrical installations? What are they? Do you see electrical installations in normal days in real life around you? Do you have an electrical installation? Yeah, I'm getting answers. Household, yeah, it is correct. What are the other things? Okay, you can, there are no such thing as wrong answers. We are learning from incorrect things we do. Just type, like, be free with me. I'm not going to laugh at your answers. And set it to direct message so others can also, others don't see your answers. Yeah, we are getting some answers. So I'm encouraging everyone to answer because otherwise this lecture will be very boring. Today we are going to do a introduction. No theory content, no calculations and all. So only two answers: household, office, industries. Okay. Can someone give me what are the electrical installations in household? Buildings. Yeah. Okay, those are the places where we can see electrical installations, right? Okay. Okay, I'm getting a few answers. Okay, good. Air conditioning, yeah. What are the other things? Yeah, air conditioning, we can take it as an electrical circuit. Yeah. What are the other electrical circuits you can identify? As there's an answer called air conditioning. Yeah, that is one of the electrical installation. There's an electrical installation part in the solar panels. So 32 students, so only few people are answering. Okay. I'm getting some other questions also. I will answer them at the end. Okay, power transformers. Yeah, power transformer. Yeah, we are going to see about them at the end. Okay, trip choices, breakers. Those are components of the electrical installations. We are going to select those things in this lecture. So what are the other things you know about relays? Correct. Okay, good. Okay, what are the other things you know? Okay, we can continue. Okay, you can type answers. Whatever comes to your mind, circuit breaker panels, yeah, components, good. Transmission lines. Okay, I'm getting other questions, not related to this module. I will answer these questions at the end. Okay, so can you guys put this question at the end? I'm very happy to answer these questions. Okay, wires, good. Okay, these are the components. RCCB, good answer. Okay, we are going to select RCCBs in this lecture. Who is this person? I can't see the name. Okay, so it is better to put your names. I'm just seeing the EN number. I don't know why. Maybe other lecturers asked you to put the EN numbers, right? Okay, that is fine. If you can also put your name, it is also fine because I can call your names also. I'm not going to make you uncomfortable, but we are going to take this lecture very, we can do this very calmly. Okay, so what are the other components you know? One person said RCCB. So do you know other components? I think someone said circuit breakers. Yeah, okay. We are going to learn about everything you said in this lecture. Okay, so this is the summary. So you can see in the lecture slide. This is the summary. Summary of what we are going to learn in this lecture. So first thing, we are going to learn about wiring regulations. This is the most important thing, and wiring regulation. So if we are going to have the in-campus examinations for your semester, I will provide you with the PDF. We are going to have that wiring regulation with your hand to do the examination questions. So you can easily go to your, when I ask about some regulation, you can go there, and I will directly not ask about the regulations. If I ask a question, you can refer to the regulation and write the answer. That is how the examinations are going to go in this module. and we are going to learn about wiring regulations. So today we are going to get an introduction to wiring regulations and electrical earthing and grounding systems. We are going to learn about them in the next lecture. Electricity demand, capacity and diversity. So have you heard about these terms? Demand, capacity, diversity. Can someone say what is demand? Don't be shy to answer. Tell me something, because otherwise this lecture will be very boring. You can, if you know the correct answer, you can put the answer to everyone. So otherwise, demand is requirement. Okay, power need for consumer usage. Okay. So you have the idea about demand, I can say, but we are going to see the exact definitions of these things in the third lecture. Then protective measures. So this is the demand is the electrical requirement that asked by the consumer. Okay. Okay. We are getting some good answers also. Okay. These all are good. Not some are good. Everyone's try is appreciated. Okay. So we are going to learn about demand. Those things we are going to cover. Protective measures. We are going to cover protective measures. We have a separate section in wiring regulation about not a separate section, separate part. You will understand what is a part in few slide. So bear with my term usages, because these some terms may feel new to you. When you are referring to regulations, you will understand what is a part, what is a section, what is a subsection. We will know these things in this lecture. So then we are going to learn about selection of cables. So selection of cables, this is the most important thing in our lecture series in this module, because when you are going to industry, this is the thing you have to do, selection of cables. To every installation, you will have to select cables. So one of the main things, and then the protective measures. So there are two separate parts in the BS7's in our regulation. We will come to that later for cover these things. So then earth resistivity studies, we have a separate lab on that. So we will measure the earth resistivity of the soil in our SLIT campus, where those things we will do. It is field work, so maybe last year also we managed to do this, because last year we also faced the lockdown, but this time I think there's a possibility to do this. Okay, we'll see. And then lighting designs, this is one of the easiest sections of this lecture series. We will know how to do a proper lighting design to your home or your future home, your the home you are planning. Then we are going to learn about electricity tariff. So electricity tariff, I think you already know about electricity tariffs, and power factor correction. So I think you have learned about power factor correction, right? Can somebody give me what is tariffs? Oh, okay. Tariffs means the billing criteria. So in your house, so you are getting a monthly electricity bill, right? So that bill is calculated according to electricity tariff. Okay, so I think I answered your question, right? So if you go to CEB website, the CEB or LECO website, where depending on the location you are in, they have published all the tariffs. So there's for the domestic customers, all the tariffs are similar. So they have a different usage level. So if your usage is less than 60 kilowatt hours, this is the cost of electricity for you. That's how the tariffs are defined. We are going to learn these things. And power factor correction. So can somebody say, have you learned about power factor correction? Just tell me yes or no. In second year, have you learned about power factor correction? Can somebody answer? Okay, you can also have yes, no answer, so I can take a vote also. Don't worry, give me answer. If you know about power factor correction, put yes. If you don't know about power factor correction, put no. Everybody, please put something. No. Uh-huh. So I think you guys have no. Okay. Yes. No. Okay. I'm seeing a lot of no's. Okay. 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 We are going to learn power factor correction from the starting from the basics. So don't worry. If you don't know power factor correction, we are going to learn. Then commissioning process. So I think you may have heard about this power plant commissioning, wind plant commissioning, those things. There's a small process for commissioning. So we are going to look at that at the end of this module. So those things are not very important for you guys, but when you are going to the industry, the knowledge will help you. Okay, I'm moving on to the next slide. Okay, this question I think I asked already. So what is an electrical installation? So you guys gave me answers about the locations. We have electrical installations, component of electrical installations. So those are good answers. Okay, so now we are going to see what is the exact definition of electrical installation. So, okay. So according to IET, the electrical installation is defined as an assembly of associated electrical equipment having coordinated characteristic to fulfill specific purposes. So to be an electrical installation, there should be coordinated characteristics. So this term is very important. So what we are going to learn in this module is what are these coordinated characteristics? So one guy is asking IET stands for. Okay, so I think you guys are in front of your computer, right? So you guys should know what is IET, because I think in last year we received IET accreditation for SLIT, right? Okay, we are also I will come to that later. Okay, IET. So you can also search in the Google, because IET is earlier called I will come to that. So in the next slide, I think it explains the answer. Wait. Okay. Now in this lecture, what we are going to see is what are these coordinated characteristics for electrical installations. So we are going to see how we are going to coordinate each of these characteristics. So that is what we are going to learn in this lecture. Okay. Okay, so these are examples for electrical installations. So simple house wiring. So one of the most common electrical installations. So in our house, there is a wiring. So that can be taken as a electrical installation, but this coordinated characteristics might not be there. Because in Sri Lanka, wiring in household wiring is done by not professionals, right? Usually the neighbors or your father has done the house wiring. So coordinated it works. So it works without an issue, but coordinated characteristics might not be there. So from this lecture, you are going to learn what are these coordinated characteristics and find out what are the issues with your household wiring. So have they selected proper cables for your loads? So those things you are going to learn. And one of the most complex electrical installation can be taken as massive high-rise building, because high-rise buildings, lot of apartments or floors, so very complex. In those complex installations, there are control systems to control these electrical installations. Those are called building management systems, BMS. So we are going to see few things about BMSs in this lecture also. So this lecture will be very interesting. Not this lecture, this lecture will be very boring, because only theory, only the only few basic things are there, but let's go and see what are there. Okay. So this is a diagram of simple house wiring. So I am taking this house wiring because I know you guys haven't seen actual wiring in the industry because you guys did not go to the training. So you can see at your house wiring and understand these components. So I know that everyone is getting the connection to your house using the CB or LECO distribution line, right? So we are getting, if your house is three phase, we are getting three lines of 230V or 400 line to line to your house. And at the house, or outside of the house, there will be the electricity meter. So everyone should have an electricity meter in your household. Otherwise, it will be illegal tampering of. Okay. You guys don't know about LECO, right? So I am getting a question. So what is LECO? Okay. LECO is Lanka Electricity Corporation or company, corporation or company. So LECO is controlling the utility supply of coastal area. I think starting from Nigambu to southern province. I am not sure about the region. But they have the control of our coastal area next to Colombo. Usually Colombo coastal areas are powered by LECO. So they are a distribution company. So you are going to learn these things in I think utility engineering in third year. I'm not sure about the semester. So LECO is a distribution company. Okay, so for now, let's take that as it is, because there are some things CB do, some things CB don't, and some things LECO do, some things LECO don't. So we are going to also learn about those things. Okay. So we have the supply coming to your home through the energy meter and from the energy meter. So now I am considering a single phase supply. From the energy meter, there will be two wires. So in Sri Lanka, there will be only two wires. So you need to know this, okay? We are going to see why. There are other countries, the lines will, there may be three or four wires. So there are some other systems also. Depending on the country, this will vary. And from Sri Lanka, you will have line and the neutral. So as electrical engineers, you should know what is line and what is neutral. So from the colors. So in here, this is not the exact color, but you should able to understand the what is line or what is neutral. So can someone say what is the blue line from your basic knowledge?
Blue is the live wire, no sir?
Blue?
Yeah.
Blue, no, actually blue is not the live wire, yeah. So blue is neutral. So actually in Sinhala, you can easily remember this by, neutral. I'm getting good answers. Okay, thank you everyone for answering. So actually in Sinhala, you can remember this by nil neutral. So nil, il pata neutral. So you can easily remember this by that term, okay, N. So you can understand what I'm saying, right? So blue is neutral and other, so usually green is earth. So in here, the green, in this diagram is a bit wrong, not in Sri Lanka. This wire also come to the fuse panel. Usually, we can also do this, no issue. You can just ground the appliance directly from the appliance. But in Sri Lanka, this is not the configuration. Don't get confused with that. Okay, so we are getting blue here and red here. Red or usually brown. This seems like red. Red is light. Okay, then we are coming to the main switch. So sometimes this main switch can be, most of the times, main switch is an isolator. Sometimes it can be a breaker also, two-pole breaker. usually in Sri Lanka, people electricians put isolators. That is fine because in household wiring we are not handling much current, so putting isolator is fine. Then we are coming to the trip switch. So this is the simple term, trip switch. So I know everyone should have a trip switch at their house. Okay, so please check your wiring. If you don't have a trip switch, is essential and compulsory for Sri Lankan household. I know some people are not using trip switches, but that is very dangerous for you. So if you don't have a trip switch at your home, please tell your parents to install a trip switch, because otherwise there will be no personal protection for you guys. Trip switch is the most important part of your house wiring. So I think everyone, okay, what is an isolator? Okay, we will come to them later. We are going to learn about all those things in the lecture 4. Okay, so for now, you can search in the internet. Okay, so because I will also prepare some documents in the course, so I will upload some links so you can get to know all those things. So it will be easy for me also, because when you are coming to the fourth lecture, you will know what is an isolator, what is an trip switch. So usually this I will continue the lecture. This trip switch, the trip switch is the layman's term. We are not calling it trip switch, so we are going to learn the correct name, I think, in this lecture. In this lecture, we are not going to learn the correct name. The correct name is already answered earlier, I think. RCCB. RCCB means residual current circuit breaker. This is actually RCD. RCCB is somewhat different. We are calling this RCD. RCD means residual current device. This provides differential protection for your household. We are going to learn about differential protection. Don't worry about the term. So that is the purpose of trip switch is, if you have leakage currents. Leakage current means, so you know in an electrical circuit, if you put some electrons into the live wire, those electrons should come from the neutral wire, should come to the power system through the neutral wire. So current in the live and the neutral should be equal. So differential protection means we are measuring those two currents, and that equal is that currents are not equal. That means we have a leakage current. So leakage currents usually occur through a fault, and fault means somebody is getting electrocuted or wire is touching the ground. Those things are fault. So we are going to find out those faults and trip our circuit. That is what the trip switch do, or the RCD do. So after trip switches, we are going to get MCBs. I think everyone knows what is MCB means, right? MCB is abbreviations for miniature circuit breaker. So actually we all call them MCB. I think everyone's house, we have several MCBs installed. So MCBs are overcurrent protective devices. We are going to learn about this. Overcurrent protective device means if you are designing a circuit for 15 amps. So we are putting a 15 amps MCB here. So 15 amps or 16 amps. Yeah, usually we keep some margin, and let's say we put 16 ampere MCB here. So if your load is pulling more than 16, actually more than 15 is also not very correct. Usually it has to pull around 1.5 times that current. Actually the value is 1.45. it depends on the breaker. If it is MCB, it is 1.45. so this will start trip. So at the 1.45 level, this will trip very slowly. If it is like 10 times the rated current, this will trip instantaneously. So these are characteristics of MCB. So we are going to learn about them in fourth lecture. And after MCBs, we have through MCBs, we have our loads. Loads means your socket outlets, and we have lamps, those things are our loads. After those loads, so you know, load should have a live and a neutral and a ground. So after going through the load, the neutral again comes to the fuse panel. Fuse panel has a neutral bar, so neutral bus. So there's a, if you observe the fuse panel at your home, there will be two buses. Buses means some copper or aluminium rods. Those are buses. So copper rods, usually copper rods are there. So all the neutrals are connected to that copper rod. And in Sri Lankan household, as I said earlier, the earth wire again comes to the fuse panel, and there will be another bus, a copper or aluminium rod for the earth wire to connect. So those things are the available things in our fuse panel. And after the earth wire, comes to the fuse panel, the earth wire bus bar is grounded. So in here, this is directly grounded. So we will see what is the purpose of this in the second lecture. So I'm not going to explain this because this is a bit complex, but I will explain it in a very basic manner in the second lecture. Okay, so if you have any questions, you can ask me. So one guy asked, what is an isolator? So I will, so you can search about it. Isolator, usually it does not do any protection. That means overcurrent or residual current, there's no protection in the isolator. So what isolator does, it disconnects the circuit. So you can get the exact definition for isolator if you Google or use some other source. So if you have any questions, you can ask me now. So up to now in the house wiring, do you have any questions? Don't be shy and just ask questions. Okay, I think everybody is familiar with these house wiring things, right? So you guys chose electrical engineers because you like these things, no? Okay. Okay. So, okay. Now I need everybody to answer. Is this a good electrical installation? Okay. Put the answer. You put your answer in the, okay. So obviously not, right? So this is not a good electrical installation. So why? Yeah, it is messy. Okay. So can some other person say what are the why do you think this is not a good installation? Okay, good answer. Okay. All of your answers are correct. Very good answers are coming. Okay. So obviously this is not safe, right? So actually this kind of, these fuse boards are North American type. So usually in Sri Lanka, we do not see these kind of fuse boxes. This is North American style. Obviously the installation is not safe, right? Okay. So then what? This is not up to standards. So if you follow a standard, you will not wire your house like this, right? This is most probably a household wiring in North America, because this, it seems this one does not have many connections. So probably a household wiring. No one will wire their house like this. Okay, this is not up to standards. And this answer I got, hard to troubleshoot. Somebody answered, very good thinking. Yeah. Can't identify issues in the problem. Okay, hard to troubleshoot. And okay, so we should not have these kind of installations, right? So obviously this is not safe. So we should not have these kind of installations. So there should be a regulation, right? There should be a regulation to regulate all these electrical installations. So now Okay, now before going to the next slide, do you know the regulation we follow in Sri Lanka? If you know, answer. So we are following a regulation from the institute we mentioned earlier, IET. So somebody asked the meaning of IET. So if you know the regulation name, tell me the name. Okay, nobody seems to know the answer. Okay. Okay, we know, obviously we know there's a regulation because I told you and many of you guys knew. And the regulation we are going to follow is BS 7671-2018. So this is the current and latest regulation we follow in Sri Lanka. And this is an IET regulation. IET means Institute of Engineering and Technology. So we got I think IET faculty, computing faculty, we got the accreditation from IET few years back. So the first institution in Sri Lanka to get IET accreditation, it was us. So we should now the Sri Lankan IET president is also from our campus, Dr. Anuradha from Information Systems Engineering Department. So we have a good connection with IET, and we are also working on getting IET accreditation for engineering degrees also. That's why we had only one issue to not get the IET accreditation, because we did not have a GPA component for first year. So now you guys are having 10% GPA from first year. So IET does not recognize our degree as 4 years if the GPA is not there for first year. So that was the issue. So I think probably you guys at the end, you guys will get the IET accreditation. Okay, so IET, so the our regulation is BS 7671-2018, and this regulation we are going to refer to almost all the parts in this regulation. So in the exam you will have this, and you will not need to bring it. I will give you the required pages and all. This one has, I think, 550 pages. So you will only need like 20 pages for the examination. So you will have to print that and get to the in-campus examination. If it is online, you can easily refer it in the computer. So I can't share the PDF of this regulation in our course save. I will share with somebody in the in your batch. So if you are, so I know that there are 32, 37 people, and maybe some of you guys are here to just check the lecture, right? So I need someone to talk to, like if there's some issues with your badge, or if I need to share these documents, I need someone to talk to. So can somebody volunteer? If there's a batch rep, you can put your phone number here. So I will save that phone number and the name, because I can't see your names. I'm only seeing the EN numbers. Batch rep, can you put the phone number here if you are planning to do this subject? Otherwise, I need someone else. Somebody who is doing the subject. So I can share, I have several documents to share with you. I think around 6 documents we need throughout this lecture series. So I need to share all of them with you, but I can't share them through the course. So I need someone so I can send the link to download these documents. So nobody is volunteering. So I have 37.
I will do that, sir. I'll do that.
Okay, can you put your phone number?
All right, sir. I'll put
it. Phone number and the name also. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you. What is your name?
Pasindu.
Pasindu. Okay, thank you, Pasindu. Okay. Okay. So I will share these documents with Pasindu and have a look at them, because if you open, I will show you the document. Wait. IET. I think everybody can see the PDF, right? Can you see?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is the IET regulation. This is 18th edition, the latest one, and there was few amendments in 2020. They added. Okay, I got your number, Pasindu. Okay, thank you. They added electrical vehicle charging in 2020. So even though we had electrical vehicle charging back in 2010, the regulation was not there. They added just a few months ago. So those amendments are free, but this document is not free. I asked Dr. Chulanta to purchase this few copies of this document for you guys. Probably, I think they will not come in January. The budget is, I think, scheduled for March. Okay, let's see. We can manage with this one. Anyway, you guys are not coming to Slitne. Okay, anyway. Okay, so this is the document. So font size is low and it's a little boring to read, but so you actually, when going through the document, you will understand how easy to understand the regulation. So this one covers everything we are going to learn in, we are not going to learn everything in here. This one covers everything we are going to learn. Okay, so I'm not going to cover everything in this document. So probably, this one has a complete guideline of how to design electrical wiring and earthing systems. So this is TN system, TET systems. We are going to learn these things in the next lecture. And how to put surge protective devices. So if you can protect your houses I think probably in Sri Lanka, this is not very common. So if you put SPDs in your houses, you can easily protect your equipments from lightning strikes. So if you have like a solar installed in your houses, they install SPDs to your home, so you do not need to worry. So otherwise, these are a bit expensive. That is the reason. I think around 2000 rupees. So people do not use SPDs in your houses, in houses. But if you can use SPDs in your houses, you can easily protect your all the appliances in a lightning strike. I have SPDs in my house. So a few days ago, there was a lightning strike very near to my house. All the houses around my home, they had burned equipment. So my neighbor had burned his refrigerator. So to my house, there was no issue because I had SPDs installed. So as electrical engineers, you should properly do your design. So we are going to learn these things in this lecture. So in this lecture series, not now, in the fourth lecture. Okay, so this is the basic idea. So don't get scared about the document because font size is also low, lot of things in one page. We do not need everything. We only need few sections, okay? So actually, I think this has 559, so you will only report like 50 pages of this document throughout the lecture, throughout the module. Okay, so don't be scared. So you do not need to remember these things because in the industry, people are referring to documents. They are not going to do all the designs by mind or by memorizing everything. Okay, now I'll continue to the lecture. Okay, so can everyone see the lecture? Type in the chat.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay, okay, okay. Okay, so you saw the document. So now this is the structure of that document. We need to know this because in the next slide, I am going to explain how we are going to name regulations. Like when you're doing a design, give me a few minutes. Give me a few seconds. Okay, sorry. Okay. So when we are preparing our design reports and everything in the industry, also in this in the assignment of this module, we are going to prepare a design report. So throughout that report, you will have to mention the regulation you referred. So actually, you are doing a design from your knowledge, but you should know where this is specified in this BS 7671 document. So you know that, but somebody else reading your design report may not know that. So you should indicate which section you refer to do the design. So therefore, we need to know the structure of this wiring regulations. So if I think I can share full screen and. Not going to work. Okay. So these are the parts. Content. Okay. So there's a huge content page for this document. So we are going to refer which section. See, there's chapters, there's sections. So when you are preparing a design document, we are going to indicate which section you refer to do that design. So then if no one can argue with your design, if you have done that correctly according to that chapter or not the chapter, usually there are sections under chapters. If you have done the design correctly according to that section, nobody can argue with your design. So we are going to do that usually in our design reports. Okay. Okay. So in the BS 7671, there are seven parts and section of appendices. And so the first part one and part two, those are, you know, the basic things, fundamental principles and those things. So actually, we are going to start from the basics, but our major content in this lecture is in this subject area section. So I think next lecture onwards, we are going to learn about characteristics of an installation, and in the lecture after that, protection for safety, same title. And selection and erection of equipment. So under this part five, I think you may have get the term now. So I said part earlier, remember which part of the BS 7671? So usually in BS 7671, there are parts. So usually in a book there are chapters. In BS 7671, mainly there are parts. Under parts, they have chapters. That's how BS 7671 is structured. And inspection and testing, we are going to do some not testing. We are going to know about testing test types and special installation locations. So we are not going to cover that part very much in here. But if you need, I can give you a few points you need to know. And appendices. The IET has included all the things you need for your examination. So in appendix, all the tables, all the curves, everything you need for your examination is included. So when I am giving you the examination paper, if it is one page, if the question is one page, if question requires one page from the BS 7671, I am just going to give you that one page from the BS 7671 attached to your paper. But if it requires few pages, I'm going to ask you to refer to these pages in appendices. So you will, I'm going to share the document with Pasindu. Pasindu, this number has WhatsApp, right? Pasindu, are you there? Okay, I think Pasindu is not there. Okay, anyway, I am going to share the documents with him, so you guys can have a look at these parts and appendices. Okay, so this is the one I mentioned earlier. So when you are going to do your design, you need to mention what chapter you referred in the BS 7671, what chapter or what section. So there's a special pronunciation for these chapters, sections in BS 7671. So usually you will read this as chapter 41, right? But in BS 761, we are going to read this as chapter 41. Chapter 41 means first chapter of part 4. So you need to know this. So if somebody has, so when you are referring to a design document, so if somebody has said section 413 of BS 7671, you can easily find where this section is. Section 413 means it is part 4, chapter 1 and section 3. So that is section 413. So you are not going to go through all the documents or all throughout the regulation to find this section. You can just go to part 5, chapter 1 and section 3. Very easy. That is the purpose of this numbering system used in wiring regulations. So as I think now everybody understands this, right? So in here, this is not chapter section 413. This is section 413. So section 413 means third section of first chapter of part 5. So very easy. So under sections, there are subsections also. Subsections are numbers at dot 1. So section number, subsection number. So if that for section 413 has few subsections, and that first subsection will be named as subsection 413.1. So you know first subsection of the third section of the first chapter of part 4. So that's how you are going to identify where these regulations are located. So if you have any questions, you can ask me. Do you have any questions now? So I really like when you guys interact with me. Pasindu is disconnected, right? Indra Kumar. Okay. Pasindu, are you there? I think somebody turned on.
Yeah, yeah,
so Pasindu, this number, does it have WhatsApp, your number?
Yes.
Ah, okay. I will give you the link to all the documents, and so if you have already logged into Coursep, I have included my contact details. So
all right, sir. I put a message, sir.
Okay. Everyone can actually use WhatsApp. Okay. So calling is a bit interrupting to me. So put a WhatsApp message and ask whether I'm available for take a call. So I will say yes and take a call. Call me, okay? So you don't call me all the time, and if you have a very important, very urgent thing, just call me. That is fine. But usually, I'm very okay with WhatsApp messages. Okay, so I also linked my phone number. If you clicked on that phone number, it will automatically redirect to WhatsApp, and you can type your WhatsApp question. Okay, what is the question you have in this module? And I forgot to mention this module also has a consultant. So you may know Engineer Timothy is he's from CB. He's not doing any lectures. I am doing all the lectures. But if you have any questions about power system, you can first come to me. If it is very complex and needs a very good experience, I will forward that question to Engineer Timoses. He is also in this module as a consultant. Okay, so you can also first come to me if it is not if that question requires good experience, I will forward that to engineer Timosis because he is now retired, and I think he was the AGM of system control of CEB, so he has for I think 40 plus years of experience, so you can he knows everything about installation, so yeah, first come to me, I will forward the question to him if there's an issue. Okay. Okay, now moving on. So you know the BS 7671, so we can't have a one regulation for all the electrical installations, so there's a scope for all the regulations. So in this BS 7671, this will regulate AC voltages up to 1000 volts RMS and DC voltages up to 1500 volt DC. So that means if your installation is installation voltage, so in Sri Lanka our voltages are 400 volt three phase or 230 volts single phase, so it is under this scope. So and you can go up to 1000 volts AC and 1500 volts DC. So can someone say why 1500 volts DC? So this is actually not a general knowledge question. So you can, looking at this figure, you should be able to, not you should be, so maybe you can deduce this value, 1500. Can somebody guess why 1000 volts RMS and this is 1500 volt DC? So RMS, this is RMS, and there should be some connection with 1500 volts. Can someone guess like that? What is the issue? What is the relationship between these two terms? So electrical circuits, you learned about what RMS voltages, peak to peak voltages, peak voltages, square root of 2. I got the answer. Okay, so actually so the 1000 volt RMS is the peak of this AC waveform will lie at 1000 into square root 2. It is something I think 1414 volts. So we are not going to limit the scope at 1414 volts. So we just say you can use this voltage up to 1500 volt DC. So that is the reason behind this. And I have mentioned frequency standards. So can somebody say what is the power frequency of Sri Lanka? What is the frequency of power line we are having in Sri Lanka? 50, yeah, you know. So do you know what are the other, okay. So good answers are coming, but 50, somebody has answered 50 without hertz, and 50 H is said. So, you know, when you are writing answers, you should say 50 space unit. So you should also consider about these things as engineers also. Okay, so your writing will indicate you are a professional in this area. So 50 space hertz, so 50 hertz is the power frequency of Sri Lanka. So okay, so thank you for answering. All the answers are appreciated. You, if you don't know, if you know it is by a guess, just put the answer. If it is incorrect, I'm not going to laugh. Just put the answer you know. Okay, and what are the other frequencies available in the if you go to foreign countries, do you know other power frequencies? Are there any other power frequencies used by other countries? Okay, yeah, now I am getting the correct answer form. 60 space hertz, very good. Okay, few answers I got, all are correct. Okay, so where we are going to, Europe 50 hertz, yes. And we are seeing 60 hertz. Tell me one country, maybe, US. Okay, So what if I said there's another frequency apart from 50 and 60? Do you know that frequency used in some electrical installations in all the countries? We have another power frequency. Can somebody, if you know, tell me? Okay. Nobody knows, right? Okay. So, okay, let's see. So we are having 400 hertz. Do you know where? 400 hertz. So 50, 60 power frequencies. So these are the most common ones. And there's 400 hertz installations. Can you guess? Probably, so you guys did electromechanical power transfer, right? I think you guys did. Okay. No, anyway, fine. So 400 hertz, in transformers, yes, transformers, every power frequency is coming. Yeah, we are using the main reason for 400 hertz is the transformer. That is correct. The transformer inside airplanes. So 400, usually the power sockets, not the power sockets, so the installations running on airplanes. So, you know, all the cockpit things and all, they run on 400 hertz. The reason is the transformer. I got few answers. When your power frequency value increases, your transformer size decreases. So if you, let's say you are transferring 1 kilowatt kVA of power. So at 50 hertz, one cycle should have, so 50 means per second, there will be 50 cycles, right? 50 cycles. So per cycle energy, there's something called per cycle energy. Per cycle energy is very high in these power frequencies, 50 hertz and 60 hertz. So not where the 50 and 60 is very close, so there will be no much difference, but per cycle energy is very high in these two frequencies. When it comes to 400 hertz, the per cycle energy is low. So that means, so you know our transformer works in the theory of electromagnetic coupling, right? So for the electromagnetic coupling, there's a core in the transformer. This core energizes and it transforms the energized energy to the secondary coil. So when your per cycle energy is lower, that core size can be smaller. So that's why in 400 hertz installations, the transformer used is very small. So that is the reason for using 400 hertz in airplanes, because when the transformer is small, your weight is low, so you can reduce the weight of the airplane. So that is the reason we are using 400 hertz. So okay, the question answers for these questions are not included in here, so you can write it down, or I'm sharing the video. This is recording, I guess. Yeah, okay. So okay, and voltage classification. So this is also you need to know. So I think you already understood the 400 hertz installation thing, right? So not required, but additional knowledge. So you can have that. And voltage classifications of BS7671. So I said we can go up to 1500 volt DC and 1000 volt AC in BS7671. It is under BS7671 if the our voltage is below 1500 DC or 1000 AC. And so don't get confused with this term high voltage for more than 1000 volts, because they have just named it high voltage because it's higher than their scope. That's why it is high voltage. Usually we do not call 1000 and 1400 500 volts high voltage. These are usually in the medium range. And so 0 to 1000, this is the scope. And if the AC voltage is less than 50, we are calling it extra low voltage. We are going to see about ELV systems in this class. So ELV, it is one of the nowadays very popular ELV. Though all those CCTV systems and now the lighting systems all are running on ELV. So now there are some companies who specialize only in this ELV industry. So ELV, there's a very high demand. So ELV is less than 50 volts AC or less than 120 volts DC. So can somebody guess why that DC we can go up to high voltages? So this is actually, this classification is done depending on the human sensation. So actually we can touch 50 volts. The 50 volts will be the threshold of pain. So if we touch more than 50 volts, it will be uncomfortable for 50 volts AC. And if we touch more than 120 volts DC, it will be uncomfortable. So DC, we can go up to 120 volts. So these are called, this 50 volts is called safe touch voltage. So so we need to know that safe touch voltage values for the next lecture and all the lectures. So very important value, 50 volts AC. We are not going to talk about 120 volts DC. So let's see what is going to come. So if you missed a few points in this lecture, don't worry, you will understand in the upcoming lecture, because this is just an introduction. Okay, now I'm going to move on to the next slide. Okay, so components of distribution systems. So okay so now I could ask a question from this, but okay, components of distribution systems. So as the slide says, any electrical installation has two components. The first one is power source, and the second one is installation. In here, the installation, in the sense, it is the load. Okay, so I have named the most basic power sources available for our distribution systems. Can somebody say other things? Because nowadays there are several power sources. Can somebody name few others? Okay, so seems no answers. Okay, anyway, so in here, I got the answer I required, the solar energy. Yeah, solar. Yeah. Okay, so now solar, because now in distribution systems, there's distributed generation, right? So distributed generators means, so you know in, so I think you guys have learned about these things in secondary electrical subjects. You have generators at, so let's say Upper Kotmale, we have, what are the generator plants we have? Now we have the largest power plant, coal power plant, Lakvijaya, and Keralapitiya, another plant. Those things have generators, but those things are not connected to distribution system. Those things are separate generators. The voltages are also different. Those things work in some other voltages, like 6 kilovolts, 11 kilovolts. Those are the standard voltages for those kind of generators. But with the trend, we are calling this in the modern power system, there are distributed generation. Distributed generation means generators connected to distribution system. And also all those things are distributed among our distribution system. So those distributed energy sources can be also taken as power sources, but in Sri Lanka, it is not advised to operate them in islanded mode. I think some of you may know what is islanded mode. Have you guys heard about islanded mode? Yes or no? Put the no. Okay, so the islanded mode is, so you know our power grid, so in solar, We are synchronizing those solar installations with the power grid. That's why if you have a grid tie solar system, we can't operate that in the when the power supply from the utility is not available. So if you can operate those solar systems without the power grid power supply, those operations are called islanded operation. So we have now in Sri Lanka and in the global trend, there are a lot of researchers are going on these islanded mode operations. So you might have heard about microgrids, smart grids, those things also. Smart grid is not a example for islanded operation, but it can island several sections. So microgrids, they can be taken as islanded operation of distributed generators. That means some section of the power system is disconnected from the main grid. That is the main concept of islanded operation. So power sources in Sri Lanka, we do not operate them in islanded operation. And electrical installation, that means the load. So load, you know, the bulbs in your home, heaters, air conditioners, those things you can take as electrical installations. The installation may contain several other components, but you can name the circuit depending on the loads in it. So we are going to see those things in the upcoming, I think, in the third lecture. Okay, so now that is the introduction for the lecture, the module. And we need to know a few things before starting the second lecture. So I'm not going to start the second lecture today, but we need to know a few things. So there's something called Earth Potential Pricing, EPR or GPR. So have you heard about this Earth Potential Pricing, the term? If the term is familiar to you, say yes or no. Earth Potential Pricing, no answer.
Actually, no, sir.
Okay. So Earth Potential Pricing is, let's say, there's a huge current injecting to ground. So when a huge current is injecting to ground, there will be a induced, we can't say induced potential, there will be a potential developed at the point of injection. So that means the potential of that ground means the earth, is increased. So that is called Earth Potential Rising. So due to this potential rising, so you know earth is very huge, and you can, if one point's potential is increased, you can't have potential gradient. That means if this is at 9 kilovolt, you can't have a point 1 kilometer away on the earth at 9 kilovolts, because these voltages will die out. So this is called voltage gradients. That means if here it is 9 kilovolts, it will reduce by going away from that point. It will reduce. So that reduction is called the voltage gradient. Gradient means actually not the reduction. So you know what is the gradient means, right? In a curve, the gradient means, so you so if you take a linear equation mx plus c, m we can take as gradient. So there will be a gradient of voltage throughout the earth. So this concept you need to know. Don't worry if you don't understand this. I will give you a video at the end of this lecture, and you will understand what is this potential rise and the potential gradient. So don't worry about this. I think this is a bit complex for you guys, but don't worry. we are not going to talk about the current injection and all, but we are going to see about these voltage gradients. I don't know whether you understood this. So the basic concept is, if there's a current injection to the ground, there will be a voltage developed at the point, and that voltage will die out when you are going away from that point. So there will be a potential gradient. That means if this is 9 kilovolts, somewhere here it will be 8 kilovolts, and at some point it will be 2 kilovolts, and some place far away it is 0 kilovolts. So that means that along a line there will be a potential gradient. So that that is a concept you need to know. Okay, don't worry if you don't understand that. Okay, so depending on those the gradient I just explained, there will be something called step potential. So let's say the potential gradient is along a line, and somebody is standing in that line. So one of his legs will be at a different potential, and the other one will be at a different potential. So there will be a potential difference between the legs of this person. So that is called step potential. So this is very harmful. So you may heard those lightning strike to ground. Some people, So I got the answer from somebody. So is that the way humans get lightning strike at that hit on a tree? Yes, that is the concept. So when lightning hits a tree or a ground, so there will be a gradient, and somebody standing on the way of that line, the lightning gradient, the voltage gradient line, he will get a shock. Sometimes this shock can be very dangerous, and there I have seen a football game few players actually died due to a lightning strike like this, which flows through the earth, and this due to this voltage gradient, few people died. So if I can find that video in YouTube, I will share that in the course web, so you guys can see how dangerous this step potential is. And in a step potential, to be more precise, when we are defining the step potential, we say our feet is 1 meter apart, usually our feet are not that much apart. So this is just the definition, and actual definition is also not a very correct definition, but this is the basic idea. And there's something called touch potential also. Touch potential means, so you have electrical appliances in your houses, right? So nowadays most appliances are covered in plastic casings. So plastic is non-conductive. But if you have let's take a PC, not a new PC with those glasses and all. If you take an old PC, PC means a personal computer case, the case is metal, right? So those metal casings around live components are called exposed conductive parts. So don't worry about these terms. We are going to learn these terms in upcoming lectures. So let's say inside of this appliance, so let's say this one is conductive enclosure. This one is a conductive enclosure, and there's a appliance, the electrical circuitry inside, and there's a fault. So due to that fault, this electrical, the conductive enclosure is at a voltage which is harmful to human beings. So if somebody touches that enclosure, the voltage between his contact point and his leg or the ground will be called touch potential. So there's you may remember I defined the safe touch potential earlier. So 50 volt is the safe touch potential we defined. So more than 50, it may feel uncomfortable to the person, and there's a curve. So if it is very the curve actually is from current. It is defined as the current through body, but if you understand what I'm saying here, sometimes this can also cause damages to humans, and you can evaluate that damage level depending on the curve. So we are going to learn about that curve in the next lecture. No, not the next lecture, I think it is fourth lecture. Okay, so touch potential is basically if an exposed conductive part is energized due to a fault, if somebody touches that, the voltage between his contact point and the feet or the reference point is called the touch potential. Okay, so those are the things you need to know before going on to the next lecture. So I am not going to start the next lecture now, so but you need to watch a video. So this video is much, so it is about this step potential and touch potential, but if you watch this video, you will understand understand this concept very easily. So I think it is not practical to share the video through Zoom, but you guys are not watching the video if I share that in the course. So you will remember that when you are coming to the next lecture. So what is the time now? Okay. Let's do this like this. So you had, okay, I'm going to end the lecture here now. So you had several questions about your classes and all at when I'm starting the lecture. Okay, so can you guys again post that? I can see the questions. Okay, so I'm going to answer these questions and I am going to play the video. Okay, so through the Zoom, otherwise you are not watching. And at the recording, the video will be at the end. Okay, so I'm going to share the recording. We have 33 people. 33 means 32 students. Okay, anyway, okay. So I had few questions. Okay, so if you have any questions regarding your degree and those things, you can ask here. So I will answer them. So if you have one. Yeah, so one person is asking if you have one or two repeats in second year and if you do work hard in these upcoming years, can we still obtain a class? Yes, you can still obtain a good class actually. So you only have obtained 30% of your GPA. So up to third year, so I will answer these questions. I am not seeing them. So first I will answer the question I'm answering now, then move on to, I'm getting a lot of questions. I will move on to them later. Okay. So if you had one or two repeats, you can even score, I think second upper class, you can easily score because second upper means 3.3, right? So at the fourth year, you have 40% of your GPA. So 40% means if you do your project very well, 40% means actually what is 40 out of 4.0? Then it is around 1.8. Okay, let's say 1.8. Okay, 1.8. If you score 4.0 at fourth year, it will add 1.8 to your GPA. And if you score 4.0 at third year, it will add something around 1.2 to your GPA. And fourth year, 1.6, right? Yeah. So 1.6 and 1.2 is 2.8. And you need only 0.5 from the first and second year. So actually you only need to score 3.3. You can easily score second upper class if you had few repeats. Don't worry, work hard. And as I mentioned earlier, this subject, as I remember, 50%, 50 students did it, and I think more than 28 had more than A minus. So you can score a very good good grade in this subject if you work hard. Hard means if you listen to my lectures very well, you will get good marks. Is it a must to take PSA module with this module? This is not compulsory with this module. You are asking whether it helps, right? Okay, let's say, so when you are doing fault calculations, I am going to cover the basics. So I think PSA is not required for this module because I am going to cover all the basics. I am going to cover power system basics because I know few electrical people will also do this subject, because this subject has the lifelong learning you need to have when you are going to the game, when you are move on with your life. Like you need to design the wiring to your home. So those things you can learn from this subject. So I am recommending even electrical, electronics and computer system people do the subject. I am specializing in electrical and computer systems. So it is better to do this subject and very easy. And so if you are planning to do your design project in electrical and automation areas, embedded systems, so you can choose me as the supervisor. So I'm very happy to supervise you on those areas. Okay, PSA module, if it is not, I don't know about the compulsory, whether it is compulsory or not, but for this module, PSA is not required. So what are the job opportunities that we have as lit electrical undergrads? I don't understand. What are the job opportunities that we have as lit electrical undergrads? So undergraduates, you are only going for... training.
No sir, I think he's asking after the degree.
Okay, so you know we have several streams, right? So electrical, power, and what are the other things, electronic and computer systems. So actually, even if networks are, we have a lot of network subjects, but I don't think people are moving to that area with this degree. Usually electrical power people, they end up in electrical installation firms, usually consultation firms, and what are the other things, solar companies and other installation areas, and when you are doing energy audit. So there are some organizations who do energy audits. So power people will end up in those areas. And some of you may have the chance to go to dialogue after the IESL, like IES, getting IESL. So before IESL, you guys are, you probably are going to end up in electrical installation firms. So usually for SLIT graduates, where it is usually take around 2 years to get the IESL associate membership. So after that, you can apply for any job, because you know people, some companies list IESL membership as a requirement. So after getting the IESL associate membership, you can apply for that. Okay. So I think I answered your question. I only talked about power people, right? So electronic people, usually they go to automation side, mostly automation, embedded systems. Sometimes the computer system people go for embedded systems. Usually electronic people, they go to Ansel, MS, so like automation engineers, innovation engineers, and some go to research side. And some choose jobs as academics like me. So if you are into research and you need to learn more, you can also choose academic areas. And for computer side, you can go for embedded systems and embedded system opportunities and research opportunities. A lot of people are going to do research, and usually our people work in a lot of computer IT companies, software companies. Our people are working on those things, those companies. Usually WSO2, I think we have, from my badge, I am EN15. From my badge, I know there are three people who work in WSO2. The salary is way more higher than senior lecturers in SLIT. So those opportunities are there. Computer system people have a lot of opportunities, but they have to work hard for them, because some people are going for, even like computer systems, there's an advantage. You can even go for a job without having a degree. So I know a few people in my batch who went for associate software engineers. Their salary was around 70,000, I think, without a degree. So computer people have a lot of opportunities, but they need to show their potential. They need to show what they can do. Okay. So what are the subjects we should follow as electrical students? Okay. So you know, in our module code, if you observe the module codes, they usually come in this way, right? EC32 something, EC42221212, I think 12 is not there. EC, the second digit is, if your second digit is 2, that means it is electrical. That means it is more electrical related. So if you like, now if you check the subject you had in second year, if you check the second digit, usually I think you had EC22 something, right? So that is electrical power. So those things are not electives. So from this point onwards, see about this second digit. So that is electrical power usually. And you can easily understand this by looking at our, the student guidebook. So go to student guidebook and find out all the modules which has 2 as their second digit. So those things are electrical power, usually power modules. Okay. And what subject we should choose? Okay. Electrical installations, I think you should, every electrical engineer should follow this, because this is the basic of electrical engineering, right? Even if your mother asks you to fix something, electrical installation is needed. Not an electrical component. I'm meaning like let's your mother asks you to troubleshoot the wiring of your house. So you need electrical installation knowledge. So those things you need to follow, and also have some automation side in your degree. Choose automation subject also, because a lot of installations go with automations. So automation, as electrical student, automation is also required. I'm talking about, I think you have asked about electrical. So are you referring to power specializing in students, or electrical as a whole, electrical or electronic? What is, I don't understand. I think this message, I don't good at electrical, so electronic design. So I want to be the electrical installation, power system, and electronic design. Mm-hmm. Electronic design. Okay. If I don't know what are the other subjects. So if you have embedded systems, electronic design. Okay. If you like, these two subjects are good. Electronic design, I can't comment on that. I didn't do electronic design. I chose embedded systems, because usually most of these installations and everything, we need control systems, and that will help you in your final year project. So you can't do pure electrical projects in final year. So better to choose some subjects with controls and all those things. I think control systems are there. Control systems you can easily use, and embedded systems. I am recommending many people to choose embedded systems because it is a very good subject. Okay. How much GPA for first class? So first class is 3.7. So you have to have more than 3.7 to achieve a first class. And actually, if you can get more than second class upper, you are in a position to apply for any job, because I know for a fact, because I also have exposure from University of Moratuwa. Our exams are tough. So considering from MSc, I'm doing the MSc there. So actually our grading is tougher than University of Moratuwa, but the knowledge base we cover may not be similar to University of Moratuwa. I'm not saying University of Moratuwa exams are easy, but our grading is tougher. I think it is because of the people we are very very worried about the quality of the people we are going to graduate from SLIT, because you know some people still have the idea that we pay for our degree and we are getting the degree without any issues. So you know, so we have to also ensure our people have a very good understanding about concept, and we have to filter out every, you know. So there are some people, if I'm not saying those people are bad, with that knowledge they can do harm to all the graduates who are graduating from SLIT. So we have to filter out them. So that is why our grading is bit hard. But in this usually grading is bit hard in second year, because second year is the filtering year. Usually if you take any year, second year has the most repeats. So if you are having repeat is not a thing to, like, you know, don't get upset. So everybody can have few repeats, but you know, you can improve yourself and graduate as a very good graduate. Okay. How much? So I think I answered your question. 3.7 is the GPA for first class, and if you're having second upper and above from SLIT, it is good. So what are the courses we can follow externally? So you can, SLIT graduates are directly taken into University of Moratuwa MSc program. So you can follow that. And if you are planning to stay in academics, I am not recommending you to do an MSc, because you know, the now MSCs are not considered as academic qualifications. So usually you should have more than MPhil or above. So did I answer all of your questions? So if you have any questions, you can ask. So I think no other questions, right? So you can, so if you choose embedded system. Yeah, PLC is related to electrical. If you choose embedded system, electrical is PSA and other second semester. What are they in second semester to do? Actually, I do not remember the curriculum. Second semester you have power system protection, then electrical machines, power electronics. I think those are the things you have in second semester for electrical people. Power electronics, even though it has the electronic in its name, it is very much power engineering. But after you answer, decided to doing embedded system and this module also. Okay, so if you are not good in programming, you will need to improve that, because embedded systems will have a lot of coding, because you need to understand. I think you guys did MSP 430, right? So you did the basic of MSP 430. In embedded systems, you are going for a very high level of embedded system knowledge. So if you are not good in programming, I'm not recommending to choose embedded systems. But if you have the courage, you can do. But the thing is, people do embedded systems and they can pass embedded system without an issue. But you know, the understanding is not there. That's the issue. So basically, you need to get the full exposure to the subject. Can you help me to choose another subject? Okay, so I will start a forum in the announcement. You guys can post all of your questions in there. Okay, so I will answer. So I think that will be good, right? So when you log into the electrical installations course web module page, there will be, I think no one is using that announcements. There will be announcements. I can start a forum which you can reply to that. So you can reply with your question. I will reply with the answer. Okay. So when you are asking questions about these modules, I do not know the modules we are offering in this year. So please post them also. Okay. Okay. PLC and yeah. Actually, automation, PLC. You need to know PLC. But in third year, this is actually, we also proposed to have PLC subjects in third year. But the thing is, you are learning PLC in fourth year. Fourth year, you have two subjects which are teaching you PLC. So actually, PLC is very much needed. You should do PLC. PLC is very easy. It does not have any programming. So you just have to draw ladder diagrams. It is like a game. So you have to draw ladder diagrams, very easy. So PLC, you should learn. Power electronics is, the electronic design is the next step of foundation of, what is the subject you had? Fundamental is...
electronic fundamentals.
Yeah, electronic fundamentals. It is the second subject of electronic fundamental is the electronic design. So this will have those high frequency analysis, MOSFET control, low frequency, those things. Power electronics is, you know, converters, power electronics, variable speed drives, what are the other things, rectifiers, AC to DC, DC to AC, those things. Actually, power electronics is, I think, taught by Sujiva sir or Sunil sir. So those people are usually electrical background people. So power electronics, you do not have to worry. Electronic design is not needed. But I'm not telling you not to do electronic design. It is also a very good subject. And this time, I think Dr. Lakmini is doing the subject. So she is very good. These are the subjects, right? Electronic design, PSA, engineering, electromagnetic, embedded systems, real time. Yeah, actually PSA is needed for electrical engineering. Engineering electromagnetics, actually it is a requirement, but I am not sure about the applications in the industry. So electromagnetic, you know, those fluxes, I think you learn these, what are those, Coulomb equation, Q1, Q dot, Q2, over 4, 5, those are the things we teach in electrical electromagnetic. So if you are I think good for knowledge, but industry applications, I am actually, I do not know. So you should consult someone else for engineering electromagnetic. Embedded systems, industry applications are very high demand for industries. Real-time operating systems. Real-time operating systems, actually also subject in high demand. But programming is there. So if you are bad in programming, actually embedded system. So you did MSP 430, right? If you can do MSP 430 programming, embedded system will not be an issue. But so in embedded systems, there you have to know about the data sheet and the architecture of the chip. So you you should have a good understanding to write a program by yourself. So if you need to pass the module, you can easily search for MSP 430 codes and use them to do your labs and assignments. But to get the great understanding, you need to know the architecture and the data sheet. You need to like, it is very different from Arduino because we are going in, I think, registry level. Registry level programming is the one we are doing in SLIT. We are not going to do those easy stuff with Arduino, but actually in the industry, you have the option to do easy stuff, but better to know the hard stuff. Real-time operating system, actually, we did not have this subject, I think. I do not have any idea about this, but the subject is good. This one talks about concurrent systems, the parallel processing, those kind of things. I think those things are there in real-time operating system. I think we had this subject as the project. We had to make a drone. So because the controlling of four motors simultaneously. So those things are there in real-time operating systems. I do not actually know about many information about this real-time systems. Okay. Do you have any other questions? Did I miss any questions? So I think the lecturer will teach the way. Yeah. I think Mr. Prabhat, right? Prabhat sir is doing. Yeah, he's very good. Embedded system. So if you like embedded systems, you should go for embedded systems because embedded systems very high demand. And also, so in SLIT we do not teach about those machine learning and AI. Those things you should do the self learning. So look up YouTube videos and like learn those things. Actually I can't recommend one subject to do, but I know for a fact embedded system is very demanding. But I heard embedded system, we are going to combine embedded systems and microcomputers. Microcomputers is offered in second year, right? There maybe microcomputer will be shifting to third year with combination of embedded systems. There was a discussion on this in the staff, but I'm not sure about the what is going to happen in the next year. Okay, do you have any other questions? Okay, so I think we can select PSI and installation. Is it good combination for electrical students? As well as I would like to know which one is good from PSA is essential. Please do PSA. I don't know whether is it not if it is not compulsory, electrical students should do PSA, power system analysis, because it is the basic of power systems. So you need to know how to do load flow, those things. Electrical engineers, you should know those things. So PSA you should do elect from these two, PSA should be your choice. Engineering electromagnetic from PSA and engineering electromagnetics, PSA, you should choose PSA. Okay, thank you. Okay, I will start the forum in announcements. You can ask me questions about your degree and all. Okay, now I think I will cut this section from the video and upload it as a separate video, because this was a discussion and I need to now play the video, because otherwise you will be not watching that. So I'm going to I need your feedback on this, because maybe the video will be breaking. Okay. Okay, give me a second. Can you see the video? It wasn't a daydream. Can someone tell me? Are you seeing
this? Yes, sir.
Okay, so I'm going to seek it to the initial point and I'm going to play. So if you have trouble with the audio coming from the coming this shared video, please let me know. I am looking at the chat. Chat is not coming. Okay, you will have to speak up if something comes. Okay. So I'm going to start the video now. It wasn't a
daydream. It wasn't a Hello? Sorry, my meeting ran late. I should be home in about a half an hour. Sure, I can pick up dinner. What do you want? Hot and spicy. That's what I'm talking about. I will. I love you too. So that's what an airbag feels like. My car! Great. I should probably get out and see how bad the damage is.
Are you guys hearing the audio of this video?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Wait. Are those telephone wires or power lines? Either way, they could be hot. No way to be sure. Don't take any chances. Just stay in the car and call 911. Good thing I actually paid attention during that safety meeting. Hi, this is Steven Stonebanks. I've been in a car accident. I hit a power pole. I'm on Highway 18, somewhere east of the 356th Street exit, a couple of miles. No, I'm okay, but there are power lines on my car. Okay, yeah, I know. I won't move until you tell me that the line is de-energized. Yes, I will stay put. Okay, please hurry. Thank you.
Okay.
Honey? Listen. I've been in an accident. I'm fine. I hit a power pole. The car is a mess, but I'm okay. Yeah, I've called 911. They're on their way. Oh, no. Hey!
Are you okay?
Hey, stay back! No, don't come any closer. You could get shocked by the ground around these downed power lines. Stay back about 35 feet and make sure no one else comes near.
Okay.
I've called 911. They're on their way. Thank you. Honey? No, I'm fine. No, don't worry. Yeah, the police are on their way. Yeah, all I've got to do now is sit and wait. Honey? I got to call you back in a couple of minutes. Oh boy. Not good.
Oh my gosh.
Okay. Plan B. Exit the vehicle. But now I gotta worry about touch potential. Touch potential is risk of electrocution based on one part of the body touching an energized object like a car while simultaneously touching the ground. Electricity flows from the vehicle through the body and into the ground, essentially making me into a human jumper cable, which would be bad. I gotta jump and land with both feet together. Whew! Okay. Now, step potential. Because the ground is energized, electrical current can travel through me if my feet aren't close together. Electrical current enters through one foot and out the other. The further apart my feet are, the greater my chances of getting shocked. So I must move away using short, shuffling steps. Shuffle, shuffle, shuffle. There you go. You got this, Steven. No large steps, just keep on shuffling. Every day I'm shuffling. Oh. I'm sorry, I can't come to the phone right now. I'm busy trying to stay alive at the moment. Almost there. Honey, no, everything's okay. No, nobody got hurt today. Well, except the, remember how we were talking about getting me a new car?
Okay, I think you got the understanding about touch potential and step potential, right? So I will also share the YouTube link for that video. So if you did not get the images from this Zoom video because of the network issues, you can listen to and watch that video again. Okay. So that's the end of this lecture. If you have any questions, you can ask me or in here or on the forum. So you guys ask a lot of questions from me. Okay, I appreciate asking questions. And okay, so if you have any questions now, talk to me. And if you have any questions regarding the lecture, talk to me now. Otherwise, I'm going to wind up the session. So if you have questions, tell me. Yes, I will upload. I will crop the discussion part and upload the lecture material only. Discussion part I will upload in a separate place. Full video I will upload in a separate place, but when I'm uploading to the lecture capture, I will use the only the theoretical stuff in that video. And so I think now Slit is not offering the free internet for lecture capture, right? I don't know the status of that. If you need my lectures in some other place, let's say like YouTube or OneDrive, Google Drive or somewhere, please put your preference on the chat so I can upload that to the whatever location you need.
So actually it's better if you can upload it to the YouTube as well.
YouTube, right?
So there are free online downloaders, so we can download them easily.
Okay, so somebody's asking, can you upload the lecture slides before the lecture? Actually, thing is, I am updating the lecture slide to the last minute. So I will upload the lecture slide, all the lecture slides, but they can be changed. Still EduScope is free for dialogue. Actually, I do not know that. That's the issue. That's why I asked about YouTube or other places. You need to check that enroll course with even without doing. Yeah, sure. You can enroll to any subject without like. Only issue is when you are submitting assignments, it will give you the. It will indicate you as not submitted. So no issues for my subject. No issue. You need to ask about the lecture. I think Google Drive link is better. Yeah, I think when I upload to Google Drive, does it automatically, it plays on YouTube player, right? Okay, I will upload to Google Drive and the YouTube. Then it is fine. Google Drive is better. Okay. Enroll to other subjects. Yeah. Okay. It is free for dialogue consumers. Okay. Good to know. So this is verified, right? Sandanet. Okay. Google Drive. Okay. And for my subject, I'm not going to mind if you are not doing my subject and being enrolled in my course. For other subjects, I am not very sure about that because, you know, you have to ask from the lecturer. It is shown in the EduScope homepage. Oh, then it's fine. Okay. So do you have any other questions? I think we did more than 2 hours, right? Now it is 2 hours and 10 minutes. Okay. So I'm suggesting to wind up the session now because I forgot about you may have other lectures, right? Okay. Okay, let's wind up the session. So if you have any questions, I will be initiating a forum in my course web. Also, you can text me through WhatsApp, no issue. Okay. So now I'm going to, okay, thank you. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So I'm going to stop the session now. Okay, bye everyone. Thank you for everyone for participating. I'm getting a lot of messages. Okay, thank you everyone.